And we're live. Like, no problems. Nothing.
Nope.
It was like
no
perfectly
problem.
Smooth transition today. Unfriggin' believable. Not a single thing went wrong.
Not one thing. Let's not even wood.
I even remembered to mute the stream so I don't have myself talking in my own ears.
Robbie just got disconnected, Briar.
Oh! We're so close. We're so close.
I mean, while you were talking, I just heard, he's fucking gone. Damn it, Robbie. What's up, man? Oh, man. I was just getting ready to tell everybody watching it. I couldn't believe it. As soon as you came on, you were like, there's nothing wrong. OBS is working. Twitch is working. And now Robbie's not working. And then fucked it all up.
Fucking Skype. God damn you. We were so close. Beasley, it's been too long. How you been, buddy?
It's been way too long, man. I'm doing great. I'm very, very happy. As you guys can see, I'm at an undisclosed location in the Beastly Fortress. I've moved into my new house. I'm in one corner of my studio. I got lots and lots of space. I've been doing a lot of setup and working this week to get this place in order. I'm thinking that this will be my little area for Beastly Thoughts. Across from me is a giant green screen. I got a nice full-size sofa. I got posters everywhere, old game boxes, console boxes. I got PSPs, everything all around me. I'm feeling really good, man. I've been missing you guys. It's been really tough.
I'm excited for you, man. Like, I love, you know this about me, right? I've said it before, is I love, like, when people do, like, their man cave.
Setups.
Their setups, right? It's like, I just fucking love it. So I'm really excited that you're doing it now. Like, you got a brand new space that you get to, like, make your very own. I wish I could be there.
Oh, man, it's so good.
Like, so I could get in there.
I even painted the walls PlayStation gray.
That is the nerdiest thing I've ever heard. I fucking love it.
I'm sorry. I am so sorry. Awesome. I had to. Yeah, it feels really good. I feel like I finally got a space that's all my own. Last night I was playing some Resident Evil 7. My wife and my daughters came in and sat, you know, watching me play on the green screen. And it's just a very homey and very comfortable place. I got plush carpets in here. Plush carpets. The rest of the house is all hardwood floor. So my wife is already trying to figure out a way to get the baby in here when she starts crawling. Like, get that little thing out of here. This is the Beastly Castle. Mm-hmm. This is my man cave. I'm really, really enjoying it. And over the next week or two, probably before the end of the month, I'll do a complete rundown video showing everybody exactly how I got this thing set up. I got my boom for my Blue Yeti microphone. You guys can't see it, but it's right in front of me. I'm feeling good about that.
What kind of boom is it? Is it one of the ones that goes straight and then has the stick going off the side? Or is it one of the ones like an arm?
It's an arm.
Oh.
Yes, that's the arm. Oh. Look, Ma, no hands.
No hands.
So, I mean, everything to me is going to really work out. I'm excited about 2017. This whole year so far has been amazing. New baby, new home. Literally 2.5 times as big as my old apartment. Giant backyard, front yard, you know, making some big changes in my life, and I'm really excited about it. And one thing I've been just as focused on, just as much as everything else, is my YouTube, the Beastly Thought Show, getting better, you know, adding new content, and I think it's going to be a hell of a year. I'm just so excited.
Nice.
Thank you, man. Nice. Thank you.
Awesome.
And I'm trying to catch you in the beard department. It's going to happen one of these days, man. Well,
One of these days, I'm going to cut it off. You know what happens when it starts getting long like this? This is about the time I'll start cutting it, because like, I wake up in the morning, you put your hands down on the mattress or on the pillow to like lift yourself out of bed, and it gets like caught, and you're like, ah!
Pull it out.
There's no way to wake up. What's going on here? Something's got me.
Oh, man. So I wasn't here last week, but I did watch the show. You guys, first of all, like always, did an excellent job. I really wish I could have been here, but I was in the throes of doing all this madness. And now that I'm back, I'm really excited to give you my thoughts on Resident Evil 7. It's a game that I've been playing. That's the game that I've been into. I told you just before the show how far I'd gotten because, you know, sporadic time in between working and looking at a new baby, taking care of the baby, unpacking, setting up a studio has only been, you know, limited time to get into it. But I have put in diligence and I have worked at playing this game and enjoying it on PlayStation VR. Let me say, and I'm sure you'll agree, the best PlayStation VR experience ever and possibly the best VR experience out there. Yeah. I've never experienced anything like Resident Evil 7 when
it's
you play
top
it on PlayStation
two for me.
VR.
I'd have a real hard time going between this and Super Hot, but this is a full game where Super Hot is like a 3-hour experience.
Yeah,
Super
well, that's
cool,
that,
but Resident Evil is like a full game.
So how many hours did it take you to complete the game?
I did a playthrough. I think it was around 10 hours, somewhere in there.
It's a full game. Yeah, and it's so unique, man. You'd expect it to just be jump scare after jump scare after jump scare, but it's not. Mm-hmm. The feeling of immersion when you put that VR headset on, you actually – I was watching myself. You know, I was doing the green screen stuff, and I watched the video afterwards, and I'm leaning all out of my chair trying to avoid, you know, certain characters and situations, looking around corners. It's just – it's something so new and something so exciting.
Did you play the whole thing in VR?
I took it off VR for about 30 minutes, and then I'd been spoiled by that point. I think it looks great either way. It looks better actually on the television screen for obvious reasons, but the VR immersion factor is just, you can't beat that. That feeling of actually being in there and knowing that these people are chasing you, and you know, the feeling of the way that they've implemented using your weapons and your melee in this game. It's so incredible, the fact that you actually pull out your gun or you pull out your shotgun or, you know, your flamethrower and you actually look at what you're shooting at. To me, that's added a whole new level, a whole new layer of the way that you play a game like this, because you're not just using your controller. You're using your controller in tandem with your own natural head and neck movement. So it makes it, you can't really miss. You're as good as you see. And to me, that makes perfect sense for a game like this. I didn't think it would be, you know, I didn't think they'd be able to implement so many things into a virtual reality game as well as they have with Resident Evil 7. The story seems really amazing. I think the game looks great. The frame rate is just buttery smooth in VR. The control scheme is something so recognizable but unique at the same time. You know, if you played any traditional first-person shooter, everything seems to work really well. It's just one of those games. I feel like after I beat this game, I'm probably going to beat it 2 or 3, 4 times, because like most Resident Evil games, once you beat this game, there's all kinds of free stuff. I mean, not free stuff, but unlimited unlocks and things like that you're able to get. Yeah. And I've always been a big fan of that in the Resident Evil series. And I think going through a game like this with unlimited, it's just going to be incredible, man. It's really good. My wife still hasn't played it in VR. She was playing it in her bedroom at the other end of the mansion last
night. VR is the way to go on this game. It's definitely so immersive. There's like the boss fights are like frantic, and like I don't know if it's easier or harder, to be honest with you, in VR, because I didn't play with the smooth scrolling on. Did you play with the smooth scrolling, or did you play with that like 30 degree?
No, like 30 lock? Degree. Yeah,
yeah. I played with that.
I got the skip.
And it was a little clumsy at times when fast action was required. I found it to be a little clumsy at times. Your character moves kind of slow anyway, and then that 30 degree thing. I found that, you know, I'm so used to aiming with my right stick in a first-person control scheme that I'd start doing that during, like, really tense fights and moving, like, then I had to readjust with my head because you aim with your head. That being said, I find it easy to aim with my head compared to, like, you know, that kind of, it's like a non-sticky first-person aiming style. And with the guys like head bobbing all over the place, I find it harder to get headshots with a controller than I do with just looking at their head and firing, you know?
Yeah, yeah. So, I totally agree. I found that, you know, the mixture of the two, I think that they've mixed them very, very well, because they could have gone all out and just made it more motion controlled design for, you know, attacking enemies. But I think that they've used it, they've kind of implemented the traditional controls, but giving you that added flexibility of actually using your head and your neck, natural movement. And it just makes perfect sense. The game feels so good when you play it. I haven't played any VR game for a prolonged period of time like this. I mean, literally every game that I play after 30 minutes max, 40 minutes, I'm starting to feel a little queasy. You've experienced that before.
Oh, for sure. But, yeah.
But I played this game for 2 hours straight without taking the headset off. And, you know, when you're playing a VR game, you're going to fucking sweat. It doesn't matter what you're doing. You start sweating, it starts coming. But I played for 2 hours straight, and I still didn't have any desire to take it off. It means that Capcom somehow they fine-tuned the development of this game, and I hope that other companies are able to utilize similar technology to make games, because this is proof, in effect, that real games can be had, played, and experienced on PlayStation VR versus these little $10 and $20 experiments like Batman Arkham VR.
No, they kind of use every trick in the book to like minimize motion sickness in that game. Like when your focus, like your view comes like down, you kind of have tunnel vision when you're moving a lot of the time. And, you know, like that 30 degree shift keeps you from like, you know,
swerving,
scrolling. Yeah. There's a lot of tricks that they do. Plus, you're in like confined environments, so you don't often have like these huge like expanses and, you know, like these like, you know, vertigo inducing moments where you're staring down into like a deep abyss. It's smartly designed for VR, especially at this, you know, beginning of VR stage where there's so many people who haven't kind of gotten their VR legs yet, you know, like,
well,
as you play more VR, you're getting more used to it. And I think our tolerance to, you know, smooth scrolling and, you know, faster action will get better.
Yeah. But for me, this is more than that, because there's a game that you and I both played that had this, you know, skip in motion when you turn, similar to Resident Evil, that makes you throw up after 5 minutes. It's called Here They Lie. You
played that game. Oh,
I played that game. Yeah, just thinking about it made you sick again. Like, you remember being back in college, like the alcohol that you would drink that would make you gag immediately. You get that same feeling as soon as you hear the title, Here They Lie. I'm like, I feel it in my throat.
Gin and Kool-Aid powder seemed like a good idea at the time.
Yes, it sure did, but it's not.
It's not. Horrible. It was not a good idea.
So the developers behind Here They Lie had a very similar style of control, not the first-person shooter or the attacking aspect, but the way that you move around the world, the way you traverse the world, the way that you turn around and look at things, very similar to Resident Evil 7's. But that game, if you play it for 5 minutes, you're fucked. You're done. It'd make you throw up like within 5 minutes.
Yeah, it was terrible.
That's the game that Kate played that she hasn't put on VR since.
Yeah. So the thing about Resident Evil 2, though, is that it's a scary game, and that's got a lot of people afraid to play it. But once you get into it, you find that there's a lot of personality to the game, too. And you actually find yourself laughing and chuckling because the characters, like the bad guys,
yeah,
they're fun. They're like fun. It's like a Freddy Krueger type of thing where, yeah, they're scary, but they're fun. They're like, it's fun to like listen to what they have to say. It's fun to watch them do what they do. You know, they're entertaining. There's a lot of entertainment value in that game. I can't speak highly enough. I told Robbie that it was my game of the year for 2017.
I'm back.
Best game I've played all year.
Well, it's still the first month, but
we'll see. Yeah, it's the only game of 2017 I'm playing, so that's a fair point.
I think it could definitely be a contender. There's some heavy hitters coming this year for sure, but I feel the same way. One of my favorite movies that came out in the last 15 years was the Texas Chainsaw Massacre, the remake. This family feels very similar to that family. When Jessica Biel was fine as hell running from these people who are trying to kill her. That family feels very similar to this family. Of course, this family has other issues, but listening to them talk, they seem like just this crazy redneck family that doesn't give a fuck.
Yeah.
And somehow that's fun. It's more fun than just a mindless dead entity coming after you. These people have their own thoughts, their own ideas. They like to eat unquestionably sick stuff, and you just don't want to end up on the menu.
Yeah.
But I've been really enjoying it. I think definitely once I play it, I'm going to try to do a speed run of it and try to, you know, beat it in the quickest time possible. I've always done that with Resident Evil games. I did with 5. We're not going to talk about 6. 4, 5, you know, Resident Evil, Code Veronica, Resident Evil 3, Resident Evil 2,
Resident
and
Evil
1.
6. Didn't know that was a real game. Never heard
it's
of
not,
that.
It's not. It's okay. It's a subgenre of Resident Evil Umbrella Chronicles. It's horrible. But yeah, I'm having a great time with this game. And it's really, it's one of those experiences that you really must have. If there's a person out there who would buy PlayStation VR just to experience something incredible, this is the game. I mean, if you have a friend who
Okay, so would you recommend a PlayStation VR? Would you recommend somebody buy that right now?
Okay, let's put it this way. Me and my brother had an in-depth conversation about this fucking Joe. Everybody say hi to Joe.
Fucking Joe.
Hey, Joe.
He's doing it right. Okay, he's doing it right now. We had a conversation about it, and he told me, you know, his wife bought him PlayStation VR. He bought the PlayStation 4 Pro. He already had a 4K TV. So everything worked out for him. And he's got HDR, so he has the best experience. But he texted me all last week, and he told me that if he didn't have this stuff already and he had a chance to actually play it, like in a friend's house or at a store, this would have motivated him to buy PlayStation VR beyond the shadow of a doubt. He said it's just – and you know what? If – I have it all, so I'm like you, Briar and Robbie. We have everything, so it's kind of hard to put ourselves in that predicament. But that Resident Evil is one of those experiences where it changes the game so much that you feel like you have to be a part of it. You have to be able to experience it. Mm-hmm. Like the first time you play like an open world third person adventure game like Super Mario 64. I know it's old, But Briar, you remember the feeling of actually picking up that Nintendo 64 controller and controlling a game like that, and it was so different from what we'd experienced, you just knew you had to have it. I think that Resident Evil 7 is very similar. If you put in the headset and you grab the controller, it's something new and something familiar, and it just marries so well together that I would say...
I wonder if in 10 years, if there's going to be a difference in the people who played Resident Evil 7 in VR for the first experience and the people who played Resident Evil 7 on a TV or on a monitor for their first experience. I wonder if there's going to be a difference in how those people remember Resident Evil 7.
Hell yeah, it's going to be a difference. Hell yeah. I mean, I was watching it, you know, I got a 40-inch in the bedroom. I was watching Kate play that last night, and, you know, she's, you know, kind of early on in the game. She has to play it in between breastfeeding. And so I was watching her play it.
Wow, couldn't care less.
Yeah. Fuck breastfeeding. Yeah, it's overrated. There. And so I was watching her play through like an early scene where Mia comes to you and she's like, it's me, it's okay. What you did to me, I'm totally fine with it. And then she turns around and basically literally stabs you in the back and stabs you in the hand with a screwdriver. I was watching on the screen. I thought everybody
would have played this shit. Have played this by now. Come on.
What's the beginning of the game? So I'm not going to tell you the part where she turns into a giant tomato and eats you. No, I'm just kidding. But now I'm fucking with people. But I watched
the game, Beastly. Damn.
Yeah, right. A big tomato. But I watched that part on the screen, and although it was fun and I saw her kind of, you know, shaking and going through her little thing as Mia was chasing her down the hall, it wasn't the same. It looked fun. It looked kind of, you know, exciting and scary, but nothing really... It's tantamount to that feeling you have when you're actually in that hallway and you turn around and you see her coming. So I think that the experiences are going to be vastly different. I mean, like, people who play on the Xbox One right now are having a totally different experience than people who play on PlayStation VR. And it's just a sad truth. It's a very different kind of experience. Do you not agree with that, Briar? Do you think that playing on the screen and playing in the VR are similar to you? Are they vastly different?
It's different. It's something you can't really describe.
It's really hard.
And I'm not saying every game is doing that
VR. No.
This is a very specific example.
This is the only example, if you ask me.
Well, there's others, I think.
Well, are there other games that you can play in VR?
I want to talk. We've talked for 20 minutes about Resident Evil. I want to talk a little bit about what I've been playing, because I'm pretty excited about it, too.
Let's talk.
All right. because Gary made me, went and got an Oculus. Gary Diaz is in chat right now. We talked on Skype for like an hour yesterday about it. I was, you know, it's Resident Evil that really got me back into VR, right? Really got me excited about VR. So I went and went to a Microsoft store. I checked out a Rift for a while. I went to Best Buy and checked out the Rift for a while. The Vive at Microsoft. The Rift at Best Buy, and. I decided to pick up the Rift. You know, there's a 14-day return policy, so I figure, you know, how could it hurt? And started playing a few games on that, and I got to tell you, I am absolutely stunned by some of the games. I checked out Google Earth. Have you guys seen that at all?
No.
No, I don't think so.
All right, so Google Earth, right? You know what Google Earth is.
Yeah.
You know, it's an app that runs, and you can spin the Earth around, and you can zoom in. Well, basically, this is that in VR. So you're basically... You can fly around the Earth. You can go anywhere on the Earth. It's got Street View in it. You can go stand on any point in the Earth. You can stand at the top of the Eiffel Tower. You can stand at the bottom of the Grand Canyon. You can go to Manhattan. It's got Street View, so all the buildings are around you.
That would be neat.
Yeah, I went to the house I grew up in.
Really?
I went to the current house I live in. Like, it's pretty stunning. And actually... when I went to the house I grew up in, it was like I was walking around, you know, and you're walking around, you know, it doesn't really feel like you're walking around, but you're in that spot. You're on the ground. You're looking at the house you grew up in. You're looking at, you know, the yard that you used to play in. And it's like, you know, there's emotion there. Like, it's pretty incredible. That's pretty cool. I played that for honestly about 15 minutes though. And then I'm like, okay, let's start shooting shit. You know, I want to start causing the pain. So I downloaded Superhot VR. Superhot, I've been talking about Superhot because it's one of my favorite PC games right now. It's just so much fun. Superhot VR is that plus, you know, infinity. It's so immersive. So the Oculus, you can get these touch controllers for the Oculus, right?
Yep.
And basically these are, it looks like a regular controller on the top, but obviously, you know, they're tracked in 3D space, and they got a trigger here and then also like a grabber here. So when you're in VR, your thumb moves in real time, your pointer finger moves in real time, and you can open and close your hand in real time. And the game is so fucking cool because you're in Super Hot and you're dodging bullets like you're Neo from the Matrix.
Oh, yeah.
And you're grabbing guns out of the air. You know, like you shoot a guy, his gun goes flying. You grab it out of the air. You're dodging another bullet from somebody else. You block another bullet with the gun, and then you shoot him. It's like, and it's all happening. I tell you, I think I'm going to be sore from playing this game because I'm like trying to balance on one leg. I got both arms like splayed out because I'm trying to shoot at two different people. I'm sweating bullets because I'm like exerting myself playing this video game, and I couldn't be having more fun. Like, it's unbelievable. It's such a big difference from the PlayStation Move experience, and I think it's the biggest failing with PlayStation VR for me is those fucking Move controllers. They're terrible. They don't track very well. They don't have analog sticks on them. They don't have enough buttons at all on them. And for the difference in the Oculus with the, like, graphically, you know, it's hooked up to my computer. It's got a higher res screen. That's great. The real difference to me is the 3D space that I have in the touch controllers, because these things are accurately represented in the game. I feel like I can aim down sight. The thing is dead steady. Whereas if I have a Move controller and I'm playing something like Lethal, like the thing's doing like this the whole time.
And oh, yeah.
Like you can hardly aim. But this, you know, when I hold this thing, it's like it's dead fucking steady.
What is the Oculus using to track your movements? Is it a camera system?
Yeah. Okay. So you can set it up a few ways. If you buy just the headset, you get one camera that sits on your desk and just kind of stares at you. When you buy the touch controllers separately, and they come with another camera, and you set those up 3 to 6 feet apart, like kind of diagonally like that. And then for another $80, you can buy a third camera and set that up behind you so that tracks you better when you're turned around. I haven't bought the $80 camera yet. I've only got the two kind of in the corners in front of me. I'm not sure at this point that I'm going to buy the third.
You don't feel like it's necessary?
Not with the games I've played so far. There's one game that I'm really looking forward to playing that I think might require that third camera. And that is, Arizona Sunshine, which I think might be I might be behind myself more. But so far, with like Super Hot, with a few of the games I've played, it's very much a stand there, move like left or right, move. Maybe I'll be facing that way, but I'm rarely facing like directly away from it. So if I start to have that problem, I might look into buying a third camera. At this point, I don't really see the need. But man, I've been nothing but impressed by these touch controllers. I did like the Rift a lot too. One of the things was that the headset was significantly heavier. Like, it just was not as comfortable as the... I'm sorry. I did try the Vive as well, too. And I found that the headset was just not as comfortable for me personally. It was much heavier on my face. And it... one of the nice things about the Oculus is it's got this kind of plastic thing that just kind of hugs your head in the back. Keeps it very secure and... It was just very comfortable. I was worried about having, like, you know, the ski mask effect. Mm-hmm. It's not like it doesn't have the headband like the PS4 does.
Yeah.
I actually find this to be more comfortable than I find the PS4.
Oh, that was my question. Wow.
Yeah. Which everybody told me the PSVR is the most comfortable one, but maybe it's just because I have a big head. I find that it just kind of squeezes my head after a while.
Could be personal preference, too.
For sure. Absolutely.
I have a huge head. You think you have a big head? Shit, I got a giant head. So
I have a fairly large head, so...
And we got a lot of big melons around here on the Beastly
Show. We got some big melons on the show.
It's a part of the contract, you know. In order to be a host, you have to have a pretty gigantic biscuit.
Giant melons.
Absolutely.
Well, I'll have more to say about VR in the coming weeks as I play more and more games. But VR right now is definitely, it's kind of my passion right now. It's just so immersive.
I love it. You know? I'm talking about, I love hearing you say that. I actually do. I didn't know, if it was going to take hold or, get that imagination and get people really into it. I've heard lots of people, gaming pundits in our community, speaking about VR actually dying, and PSVR in particular. And
When I look at the games that are coming out in 2017, I think this is the year that we're going to actually see, games come out for VR. Last year was all these demos and, experiences. I think we're going to actually see games come out for VR, and that's going to turn around.
To me, the great thing is, and see, the only thing I can really use as a great example is the one that we've already mentioned, is PlayStation. I haven't played Super Hot. I hope it comes to PSVR.
I hope so, too.
I'm not a big PC. And plus, I don't think that this laptop, this Asus UX501, could actually run Oculus. It's a mediocre, at best, gaming PC at this point. But I would love to get my hands on it and try it. Maybe I'll download it on Steam and just play the regular PC version just to kind of get a feel for it. But at least now we know that true games can be made for PlayStation VR and made for VR experiences in general. Now that we've seen top development. What is that? Something's killing my ear. What is that?
Robbie tapping on the desk again.
I'm tapping my mouse. Okay. this mic is so sensitive.
But the thing is, now that we've seen top-tier development, talented people create a game like Resident Evil Biohazard, we know that there really isn't an excuse. People just need to tap into whatever techniques they use and bring more immersive and incredible experiences to virtual reality, because now it's time. Now we've seen it. I'm really excited. Robbie, you want to quickly go through whatever you've been playing up there in Canada for the last 7 days?
Yeah, for sure. First of all, I want to say, unfortunately, I'm sure you guys went over it and told them I was having internet problems. Like, as soon as we were about to start, the internet just dropped. I'm like, oh, shit.
It wasn't you, Briar. It was not OBS, and it was not Twitch. So
it
you're
was
still,
me today. Yeah.
You're still one for one, Briar. Good shit.
Still my lucky day. It's Rob, not Robbie's lucky day. It's my lucky day.
My day fucking
Who's
sucks,
having a lucky
apparently.
Day? This guy.
There you go. But yeah, thank God I reset the internet router. Everything seemed to be fine. Hopefully it'll still be fine. But anyways, this week I have been playing a lot of Resident Evil 7. I've been playing the full game. I've beaten it twice now. Or no, I've beaten it once, and I'm playing through Madhouse. I've played the shit out of the DLC, which is amazing. I'll get into that. And first of all, I just want to say that Resident Evil 7, I haven't played it in VR, but my first playthrough, I really think this is one of the best games I've played in a long time. This game is really something special to me. Everything about it, from the atmosphere, the location on the Louisiana swamps, all the houses, I think it's amazing. The Baker family is incredible. They are just creepy as hell, and they scare the shit out of me. They are a weird family, and amazing game. I loved it. I really just want to play it in VR. Absolutely. Like you guys said, it's even better. And I can't even imagine that because I already like it so, so much. It was just so good. Every corner you turn, you don't know what's going to be there. And you're just scrambling to manage your inventory. I loved the heck out of this game. DLC makes it even better.
If you don't mind, go over what you get with the DLC. Don't spoil anything. But I saw this DLC and I was like, holy crap, the game just came out and they've already come out with DLC. Wow, what is the DLC? And you said it's really incredible, so enlighten us, please.
Yeah, I'll be very careful, of course, to not spoil anything. So there's three pieces of content you get with the DLC. The first one is you get two separate episodes. One's called the Nightmare Mode, which is basically a survival mode. You're in the basement of the main house, and you have to... basically, what happens is you turn these machines, you get a currency, you have to spend money on ammunition and weapon upgrades and things like that. You can set traps for a certain amount of money, like you can set up like an explosive barrel and shoot that. You can set up turrets. So it's basically, your standard kind of survival mode. You have to survive until the morning. It's really cool. I've played a bit of that and had a lot of fun with that. The next one is an experience called The Bedroom. So if you guys remember from the main game...
We've experienced that, Ravi. Briar and I. Go ahead.
Shut up. But yeah, anyways.
Got it!
Continuing on. Fucking got him. But yeah, if you guys remember from the beginning of the game, one of the videotapes, the cameraman Clancy, that's actually who you play as. He's trapped in the bedroom with Marguerite. Basically, you wake up handcuffed to this bed. Marguerite brings you like this food. Of course, it's some nasty, disgusting shit. And she's being like, I made this just for you, all creepy. And basically, you have to escape the room, and it's like a giant puzzle. You have to find different pieces. You have to look like every inch in the room to figure your way out. And what happens is, if you make too much noise, Marguerite will actually come back in and say, "What was that noise?" And if you're not back in bed, she will fucking kill you. And so you have to reset the room back to the way it was and make it look like nothing was touched. And without, spoiling too much, like, it was just amazing.
That sounds really awesome.
Yeah, it's great. It's just one big puzzle trying to escape this room, trying to find all these little clues and notes hidden. It's really cool. All these different items. And I absolutely loved it. And then the final piece of content in the Volume 1 DLC is this mode called Ethan Must Die. Now, have you guys heard anything about this mode?
I have not.
Oh, let me tell you, this is, like, tougher than the Madhouse mode in the main game. It is ridiculously hard. I still have not beaten it. So basically what happens is you're at the start of the main house. You have no inventory whatsoever. You have no items, and you have to go basically get all the way through the house, find all the stuff you can, save as much ammunition you can, and you have to kill Marguerite at the very end. And basically what happens is there's these boxes hidden all throughout the house, all throughout the way you go, and there's like different levels. You'll find like a flamethrower, you'll find a handgun, you'll find a shotgun, and it's completely random too. Every time you play it, you get a completely random set of items. You don't know what you're gonna get. So you may get nothing but health kits, and you may not get like any good weapons. You might get like three handguns in a row, but nothing else to defend yourself with. You might just get a knife. You don't know what's gonna happen, and it is crazy hard. It's like one hit and you're dead from any enemy, and there are so many moments where it's really tough. I still haven't beaten it. Like, it's freaking hard, but it's really, really cool.
All that stuff sounds fun. There's so many traps. But I want more story. Like, these are nice little side pieces for $10. I don't even know if I'm going to buy it. I'm going to wait to see. There's another DLC coming out, you know, what, in a week or two?
Yeah, a week from now. Yeah.
I want more story, man.
So, like, wow, there's two DLCs already? Okay, what's the second DLC about? Yeah, and then there's,
in spring, they got a free one coming out.
Yeah, there will be
free content. So is there going to be more story with the second batch of DLC? You don't know yet?
I think the spring one has more story. I don't know about the second one in February.
One thing that I heard that's a little disheartening about this DLC is that it's not playable in VR. I think that's true.
Part of it is, some of it is not. Yeah. Okay. Ethan Must Die, I believe, isn't. I think the rest of it is.
The rest of it is, yeah. You're right on that.
Okay. Well, it sounds interesting, and I'll more than likely end up buying all the DLC for this game because I'm totally in love with it. All
right, I will say this, though. You guys are right. It's not really story content. This is side stuff, but what's there is really cool. But it does disappoint me that this wasn't in the game to begin with, right? I mean, it's awesome. I love it. Every single piece of content is super cool in this. But
it seems like some of it could have been included. The fact of how long has the game been out? It's been out for what? 2 weeks?
2 weeks, not even, yeah.
And they've already got two batches of DLC out. It seems like some of this stuff could have been, well, at least they're going to give us something for free at some point. But
at least the content so far is good. Like, it's really good, though, what they've done. So, it's cool stuff.
Yeah. All right, so we do have some news for this episode of Beastly Thoughts. Super Bowl Sunday episode. Robbie, would you like to get us started?
Wait, what? Is it Super Bowl?
Yeah, it's the Super Bowl, man.
Don't go, Breyer,
no, don't leave us.
I gotta watch the Pats kick the Falcons' ass.
Dude, that's why we did the show early today, to not miss it. That's why we're doing it early today. So,
you know, Cortana agrees with you, Breyer. I asked Cortana about, what time the kickoff was, and she did say the Patriots would win. I was like, holy shit, really? Aren't you just, artificial intelligence? And she was like, yes, I'm very intelligent. I was like, wow.
There you go. Because
I live in Atlanta, and, I got to represent where I'm from, and it is what it is, but we'll see what happens later on. And the last bit of news is about Destiny, Breyer, so don't leave.
Yeah, Breyer, please don't leave. We'll have enough time to watch the game after this.
All right, Robbie, get us started with the news, Robbie.
All right, first bit of news today. Nearly 10% of all Resident Evil 7 players have played the game in VR. So this isn't just on PS4. This is across the entire player base, which is really cool to me, man. Wow. Really cool.
Well, it's really great news. I'd love to get information or at least get some idea of how many PSVRs have been sold. We're getting more
PSVRs. I think that information is out, isn't it?
I don't know. I haven't seen any. I got some news coming out later on this week, maybe today or tomorrow, a video that I did yesterday, where we're getting our second batch of PSVRs this month. And it's going to be two batches. One of them will come with the PSVR Worlds, and the other one will come with what's the shooter, the scary shooter? The only other good PSVR game that came out way back in the day where you got both move controllers. Guys, help me. No, Hayden Panettiere made the original, was in the original game. Rush of Blood.
Rush of Blood?
Yeah, it comes with Rush of Blood. I'm sorry. The name was, you know, missing.
Well, they're basically the same game, kind of. It's just Until Dawn, though. You're right. That is separate.
Yeah, Until Dawn, Rush of Blood's coming with one new pack for the PlayStation VR. It comes as a pack in, and also PSVR Worlds. But it sounds like Sony's finally trying to meet the demand. I'd love to find out how many people have actually bought this thing. And I want to know.
I didn't even know that thing was out of stock everywhere, but apparently a lot of people have been, like, waiting for the second shipment.
Yeah, I go on GameStop at least twice a week, and I haven't seen any of them.
Really?
Just no, they're completely gone.
So you know, this is great news about the 10% thing, though, because if this is like a significant reason people are buying this game, then it incentivizes other developers to include VR in their game. You know, and hopefully, you know, as more people see, you know, great VR experiences, it incentivizes more people to buy into the VR hardware and then increases the user base for VR software, which means more development dollars go into VR software, right? Mm-hmm. So it's like this cascading thing. And the fact that this is in the news and that, you know, clearly Capcom is very pleased about this and 100,000 users are playing in VR, that's great news. Like, if you're excited for the future of VR, this is great news.
Well, yeah. I don't know exactly how many Resident Evils are sold. It's the last I heard was like 2.6 million it sold. So 10% of that is on PSVR. And that was at least 4 or 5 days ago when I heard this information.
Are you guys sure that it's 10% total and not 10% on PSVR?
It
says 10% of Resident Evil 7 players are playing in VR of all Resident Evil. Yes, it's
total.
Players.
It is. I checked out.
So, I mean, that's exciting news. And who knows, man, if PSVR is able to pick up after games like Resident Evil 7 have been released, PSVR 2 is probably be coming right around the corner in another 18 months or so.
I have a feeling, too, that RE7, most people just bought it on PS4.
You think they should wait on it?
Yeah, probably. you gotta let people enjoy their hardware a little bit. I think they'd wait until the next iteration of the console cycle.
PS5? Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
I don't think that the PS4 Pro is really capable of pushing that hardware much further.
Oh, and just so you guys know, I was watching one of my favorite podcasts, PlayStation PS I Love You XOXO, and a very smart gentleman by the name of Colin Moriarty agreed with the Beastly Gamer that we'll see the PlayStation 5 in 2018. Just want to let you know.
It won't be announced this year. There's no chance, though. You're crazy. You're crazy on that.
All right. I just might be. But okay, continuing on, For Honor will have an open beta on PS4, Xbox One, and PC from February 9th to the 12th. It will include a brand new elimination mode and is available to everyone. I haven't played this game.
Oh, it's fun.
You guys have. Yep. Would you like to share your thoughts with me? I would really like to know if this game is worth picking up. From the little glimpses I heard from you guys last week, it sounds like it's definitely worth buying.
I missed it. What game are we talking about? I was reading chat.
For Honor.
For Honor. Oh, yeah. Okay. It's cool. It's a cool game.
Okay. It doesn't feel like a traditional fighter? Or, I mean...
No. It feels something completely unique. So you got the two thumbsticks, right? You're running around with, you know, the left one. But the right one, when you're in a fight, it changes your stance. And it changes where you attack from with your sword or whatever your melee weapon is and where you're blocking. So... if it's me versus you, I might swing from my right, which means you have to block to your left. But then you don't want to counterattack from the left because you know I'm already guarding on that side. So you want to quickly switch. And
oh, wow.
It's a lot of fun. I think it's a high skill level, a high skill cap on this game.
A lot of patience, too. Timing is super important in this. You got to time your attacks. And yeah, you got to just kind of outsmart somebody.
It's slow movement, almost like Dark Souls. So it's very methodical. You're not just spamming buttons.
Yeah, you're
running out of stamina. You can fight 1v1, you can fight 2v2, or you can do this like Dominion mode where it's 4v4, but there's also like an NPC army in there. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's basically a large scale battle. It's pretty.
Yeah, cool. What I'm really looking forward to seeing is if what the I really want to know about the single player campaign because that's going to convince me to buy this or not.
Yeah, and I think the other
thing
too.
Just the way you described it sounds really interesting already.
It is interesting. I'm glad I played it because I don't know if I'm going to buy it. I think I'm going to buy it, but it kind of depends. There's a lot of really good stuff coming out right now, and I don't know if I'm going to be able to devote time to it. You know, and I think it's one of those games you got to devote a lot of time if you expect to get good.
Yeah, and the thing is, when I played it, I'm like, I really like this game, but this totally depends on friends playing for me to get it. Like, I like it. I know I like it. I like the combat. But this is such a team-dependent game. I'm only going to get it with friends.
Yeah. Well, it goes back to that old saying, Robbie. It ain't no fun unless your friends can't get some. All right.
Yeah, that's the thing with For Honor. Definitely. That applies. We're not talking about sex. We're talking about... Let's move on.
All right, so this is exciting news. Additional details have been released from EA regarding this year's Star Wars Battlefront sequel. Reiterating, the game will have a single-player campaign, promising more heroes and characters, and it will take place not only in multiple locations, but also different eras within the Star Wars universe.
How are you guys about Battlefront 2 at this point in time?
I just bought Battlefront, like, the other day.
What?
Yeah, it's on sale right now for $10. It's on sale right now for $10. Yeah, so I don't really have any interest in playing the game, but I figured, you know what? I really want to play that X-Wing thing they have in VR. So for $10, I picked it up. And, you know, if I goof around with it a little bit, I do. If I don't, You know, for $10. No, I haven't tried it yet.
It's okay.
Right now, actually, there's a huge sale on PSVR games.
Huh?
There is.
Yeah, it's like a big sale. Like, a lot of games are like 33% off, like, in that range. So have you been kind of eyeballing some of those games, thinking, you know, I know I'm going to play this thing for a half an hour or an hour. Is it really worth $10 or $20? Well, maybe 33% off.
Thank you for letting me know that. I'm going to definitely check it out. There's a few games I've been on the fence about. Some that I really want, like Tumble VR, which is just a nerdy stack the block type of game, but I really enjoyed that experience. There's a few of them that I really want to get, but I've just been on the fence kind of waiting for a deal because you really don't see PSVR deals. So thank you guys for letting me know about that. I'll definitely be looking into it. But Star Wars, I think that, you know, when it first came out, it sold like bananas. I mean, it was just insane how many people were buying this thing, buying the console. Overall, it's not a bad multiplayer shooter, but the aspect of Star Wars that people have always loved and cared about have been the stories and the worlds. And I just feel like if you do an online-only type of player versus player experience, you'd miss out on the potential of exploring more stories and characters. So it's good to hear that they actually the part of this that's really exciting to me is this is a game that has a full single-player campaign. And I think that if you're going to make a game like this, barring things like Overwatch, that has to be a part of the package. So I'm actually excited about it. Overwatch, I don't really complain about because that game is just so damn fun. It is.
Yeah.
Overwatch is a very
that's got fun. Replayability too. Like they nailed that. Blizzard really just knows how to do that kind of stuff. They're the masters at it.
All right. So continuing on with our news today on the Super Bowl Sunday, BioWare is currently at work on an entirely brand new IP, unrelated to anything the studio has done before. Not many details were revealed, but the game is confirmed to have multiplayer integrated in some way. The game is planned to be released by March of 2018.
This game is coming within a year. Like, damn, they must have been working on this for a while now, which is awesome.
Yeah, really cool. You know, they must have another team working on it because I know that they're hard at work on Mass Effect Andromeda.
That's the Quebec studio. Yeah. Okay. This is probably Edmonton because they haven't released anything since Inquisition. So this would make sense. It's probably Edmonton working on this game. I'd think so.
Well, I know this next little bit of news is going to make my brother Joe very sad. We all know Joe he's made some mistakes in the past.
Goddamn, Joe, you're a complete joke.
Nintendo.
We love you.
Robbie just fucked you up, Joe. Okay,
get fucked.
Nintendo has officially ended production of the Wii U globally this week. No more Wii U consoles will be manufactured. I could just see a tear dropping from Joe's eye now because I swear to you guys, I'm not joking. Joe and my friend Lewis both said that they thought that the Wii U was a better proposition to buy when the PS4 first came out. They said the Wii U is better. It's a better deal. It's better games. And, of course, now Joe is, like, balls deep in PlayStation 4. He just joined the 8th generation and a half ago because he's such a loser. He texts me constantly about Resident Evil, telling me that Bloodborne is the best game he ever played in his life. And guess what, Joe? Bloodborne is not on a Nintendo console. You're my older brother, but grow up. All right. Continuing on.
Just a little convincing, that's all. We convinced them.
Bungie and Activision have filed a trademark for DestinyCon. Briar, would you like to talk to us about this?
Take it away.
So, my views on this have actually changed. I made a video about this when the news first broke, and I was pretty excited about it. I'm like, there already is a Destiny-related con. It's held in Florida in the summertime. It's called Guardian Con. It's run by the community. It's run by King Gathalion and Professor Broman and Kevin. Yeah, I forgot his name. Kevin Vision 101. K-Magic 101. Sorry. So I was kind of thinking, hey, wouldn't it be cool if that was happening on the East Coast in the summertime and this Destiny Con, you know, officially the official con held by Bungie and Activision was held on the West Coast in like the winter time. So every 6 months you got a con and one was on the East Coast, one was on the West Coast. And the more I think about it, the more I think that they're just protecting their trademark here. You know, originally Guardian Con was called Destiny Community Con. Bungie asked those guys to change the name of it, and I think they're just protecting their trademark.
I don't think you're right about that. Con. Wouldn't that be cool, though, if, like, they announced Destiny 2, and then at the same time, they're like, we're having this huge convention, we're going to reveal a ton of details. That would be kind of neat, though.
I mean, I'd be excited, you know, like, it's more opportunities for Guardians to go and meet each other, more opportunities for, you know, Bungie to meet their community, more opportunities for news to come out, you know, like, all sorts of good stuff could come from a Bungie-held con.
Absolutely.
I'm not convinced it's going to actually happen, though.
Yeah, I'll stick with Guardian Con. I like the cosplay, man. I like them girls in them cosplays. And nothing better than a sexy Guardian, man. Take her home with you.
I was going to dress up as a hunter this year. Being a sexy cosplay, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, got you, baby.
Bro, I want to see that. Oh, yeah. Oh, have that beard at full display too with that hunter outfit. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. His beard will be coming through.
Under the helmet?
Yeah. Where's Briar? Oh, there he is right there.
There he is. That motherfucker can't hide. Don't make helmet. It's big enough for you, motherfucker.
All right, so this next little bit of news is, I don't know if I even believe this, because I personally don't think that the Nintendo Switch is capable of this, but Nintendo president Tatsumi Kimishima has
sparked that again. Interest. Bless you.
Tatsumi Kimishima.
You wipe that off the monitor.
Has sparked interest of VR integration with the Nintendo Switch, stating that the company will support VR with its newest console if it can resolve the issue of playing VR comfortably for long periods of time. I'm sorry, guys. I'm far away from the screen. I'm getting old.
No, it's all good. Vision goes sometimes when you get older. It's
I love Canadians.
So you don't believe them? You don't believe that they're going to do VR?
Look, Nintendo, they only change when they fuck up really bad. Like right now, they fucked up with the Wii U so bad that they had to completely change and go in a completely different direction. I think it's going to work out. But the bottom line is, I don't think that the Switch has the capability to play virtual reality type of games or have that kind of experience. I don't think it's powerful enough.
It does like Gear VR or something like that.
Yeah, it would have to be, right? Because you're totally right, basically. Like the power is... I was wondering that too. I'm like, is this thing even powerful enough, or would they have to really just figure something out?
And plus, I don't believe anything Tatsumi Kimishima says anyway, because he said that in response to the outcry of Nintendo fans of the lack of reasonably good launch titles for the Nintendo Switch, his statement on that was, even though the only really good game that people are excited about is the Breath of the Wild, we're going to release games like every 2 or 3 months. Instead of, you know, kind of waiting for 6 and 8 months before we release
a
good
game. Damage controlling. I mean, corporate people.
So he's already learning to flip the script. This is the no spin zone, Tatsumi Kimishima. And that's bullshit. You know, if I'm going to buy a Nintendo Switch, I don't
he's
want
to. He's calling you out. That's bullshit.
One good game.
I love it, basically.
We need to have at least 3 or 4 good games for the Nintendo Switch, you know, during launch. Because honestly, that's the only game that anybody cares about right now is The Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild.
Yeah, and you can play it on your Wii U, and it's basically the same experience.
That's my whole point.
Which is what I'm going to do. I'm going to play it on the Wii U. I'm not buying a console just for that. I'm sorry. I'm excited, but not that excited for it.
I'm honestly thinking about not buying it. Like, I'm really thinking about it. Well, I want to play Zelda. It looks like a really cool Zelda game. But fuck, I bought the Wii. I played Wii Sports. I never played any other games on it. I bought the Wii U.
He's thinking about what he played.
What games came out for it again? Hold on.
I bought the 3DS and the new 3DS and the 3DS XL and like, you know, I play like one game and then it's
and
like
the new
onto
3DS.
The real games. You know, like
yeah.
Nintendo makes great games, but they're not really marketed at me. We've talked about this before. They're not really marketed at me. Like I enjoy a good Mario game, but it's not something I'm going to dig my teeth into for, you know, a year or 2 years. And they don't make games rapidly enough to really justify, you know, a $300 console.
Completely agree with that. Yeah, that's the problem for me too. It's like I like Nintendo games, but it's not enough. Like you have a couple games. They're great, but they're not like I have to absolutely go buy them or get this console. There's not enough of them for me. There's some great stuff I want to play for sure, but it's not quite enough.
The reason Nintendo won't fail is because although we all get older and our tastes change, there's a lot of people having sex every year and they're making children, and these children all love Nintendo games. So it doesn't really matter. You know, they're like, oh, you're older. You're moving away. Get the hell out of here. Send your kid to me.
Beasley, I don't want that kind of talk. This is a family podcast.
This has always been a family show. What is wrong with you, Beasley?
God damn, Beasley. What is going on here, man? You like all night with the dick jokes and the sex jokes. This is a family podcast, man. Beasley.
I'm sorry.
Life is in chat.
Oh. Hi, Miss Rabbit.
Hey. I knew she was in there, and I was like, I wonder what she's thinking about this.
And look, she thinks I'm such a good man.
You're a nice guy, man. Don't worry.
Just ruined
about
my
it.
Image.
We love you.
Hi, Miss Rabbit. And look.
My wife told me to say that.
Okay. All right, so the last little bit of news we have for Beastly Thoughts today concerns the PlayStation 4. As you guys may have heard, there's a new PlayStation update coming that is going to enact some pretty serious changes to the PlayStation 4 hardware. PS4 System Update 4.50 will add a boost mode option to the PS4 Pro, enabling some of the unsupported PS4 Pro games to run at higher frame rates. Awesome! That is cool, right? That is cool! Because I'll have my PS4 Pro probably within the next week or two. I mean, I'm figuring everything out. And you know what the weird thing is? It's not going to be in here. I'm keeping it inside the living room because I want the 4K TV in there for the family. I don't want to hoard it and kind of keep it all in here to myself and tell everybody to get out. They walk past the studio and say, ooh, that looks beautiful. I'll say, close the door. Boom. They can't see anything in here. Just not right.
I'm
putting the Pro in there, the 4K TV. But I think that's incredible for some of the games that aren't supported in PS4 Pro. That you can maybe, you know, boost that frame rate from 30 to 60. That's what a lot of people have been wanting more so than anything else. There's a lot of gamers out there who'd much rather have that smooth frame rate or faster frame rate over, you know, a better resolution.
Yeah. Destiny players say hello.
Absolutely, yeah.
Yeah, I think a big thing for Destiny 2 is 60 frames, too. People really want that. That's big.
Well, it won't happen with Destiny. That would change the whole paradigm of the game.
There are parts of Destiny where there's some significant slowdown, though. And it'd be nice if that got cleared up.
Yeah.
Breath of Machine Raid. Yeah.
All right, guys. I got to talk about something I saw on Twitch. Have you guys seen Conan Exiles?
Yeah. Yes. That looks like a fun game.
I saw the trailer. Yeah. Yeah, I saw the trailer.
You got to go onto Twitch and watch some streams of Conan Exiles.
Why?
It is hilarious. Really? It is the funniest really thing I think I've ever seen on Twitch. I think you can just tune in on to any Twitch streamer. Make sure I tuned in. Wilson's in chat and he told me about this guy, Mr. Moon, who I followed, and then I started watching him play Conan Exiles, and it was right at a point where he died, so he was buck ass naked and he had to go across the world to go pick up his gear that he dropped.
What?
Right? Apparently, when you make a character in this game, one of the modifiable attributes...
Oh, boy.
No way.
...is the size of one's member.
What?
Yeah. Yes,
Mr. Moon had a lot of fun with this and made one that was very large.
What? What the fuck is that?
He's running around in Conan Exiles. He's buck naked. The thing is like flopping between his legs. You know, you're in that third person, and you can see it, you know, because you're behind him, but you can still see it. But I almost lost my shit when he crouched down and the thing was nearly dragging on the ground. Oh,
wow. Holy shit.
It is so worth it. It's so funny. The chat fucking the fucking chat was like, what the fuck is that?
Seriously, wow.
Oh my god, it's worth going to see. It's a spectacle. Like, just it's so funny.
That's the only word that can describe that.
So definitely check out a Twitch stream this week.
So this game, it's on PS4, Xbox One, and PC.
I don't think it's on console,
is it? I think it's coming to console.
Oh, well, it's not yet. Okay.
Yeah, it might not be out yet. Are they going to, you know, drag that back or maybe pull some of that back for consoles? And see, I've never seen them go that far. Drag it back.
Jesus. No, the penis sizes are totally appropriate. Don't worry about it.
I don't care. You know, to me, I'm not like one of these liberals who gets offended by shit. To me, it's funny, but it's hard for me to believe that something like that, you know, went through R&D or something, and they were like, it's totally fine. Big dicks are fine with us.
There's a slide
on the ground.
You get
don't
to adjust the size of your.
But I'm trying to see how member. That affects the game.
The Twitch stream fucking hilarious. That's what it does. It makes your game more popular because there's huge fucking dicks dragging across the ground when you're crouch walking to get away from a saber-toothed tiger.
I mean, is it like The Witcher? Are there going to be sex scenes, and do they affect the outcome of the sex scenes?
You know, it's one of those survival games with like crafting, and
it's very similar to Rust.
You build your weapon. Your weapon can wear out, so. You know, shit hits the fan.
Gotta use it.
Swing that thing out.
Swing that dick around. Just, you know, beat up that saber tooth.
Yeah.
Beat it to death with your.
You might want to keep it away from the saber tooth, Robbie.
Down below.
Robbie, saber tooths and big dicks don't work, you know?
Well, maybe they do. I don't know.
Trust me, they don't.
Don't knock it until you tried it.
Exactly. The prehistoric cavemen must have done it, yeah.
My God.
I think Robbie's packing over there. He's got.
Yeah, I think so. Fuck California, love Canada, love. Go ahead, Canada. I knew you looked black.
What's happened? How do we get here?
Man, one little conversation about a perfectly innocent dick slider.
Brian, we were just talking about this as a family show. Too,
I mean, and this is the guy who says Beastly is a family show.
About full man's dick dragging on the ground.
You know, I gotta check out this game because it seems too.
It's funny.
It's really funny.
It is funny.
Yeah, I've watched.
Like, I'm not big on survival games, but it's funny to watch. And so Mr. Moon is a great streamer. Wilson told me about him, and he's a fun streamer to watch.
And I'm guessing that game's available now. Is it? Is he playing a beta? Is he playing the full game?
It's alpha, in like early access or.
Yeah. Okay.
You have to pay $40 to play a, you know, unfinished game. You know.
Yikes.
Steam. PC games.
Absolutely. Yeah, I've done it.
Survival. It hits on all of the keywords of 2016, 2017. It's survival, early access, Steam.
That's it. You know? How the hell is DayZ still isn't fixed? It's still not a complete game.
Are they even working on it anymore?
I don't know. I had to buy two copies because you can't share that game on Steam for some reason. You can't share.
It's still come to PS4. But
I bought two copies and Kate played for 2 hours and that was it. $25 wasted. Load of shit.
Yeah.
I like my game's complete.
I feel like we're like kind of petering out here. It's like all of a sudden we're going strong and then I brought up, you know, dick sliders.
Big
and
dicks.
And everything went downhill. Everything,
the only time I like to talk about big dicks is when my wife is talking to me about mine.
Oh, Jesus. Yeah. Okay.
Too far, man. Too far. Come on.
Oh,
it's
sorry,
a family show, Beastly.
Beastly, that's just messed up. What if your kids are watching this or some kids? That's crazy.
My kids, my son, they're like, I know what he's talking about.
Dude, chances are, about the sons, like, the I think one in every certain person in the Listen, world guys. Is one of Beastly's kids, so chances are one of them probably watching.
You got that right. don't fuck around, man. I wear a size 4.
I'm concerned about Nina or Nova, not your sons. No, just little girls.
Listen, they're in their bedroom watching Chase, okay? And that's all I know is the little kid's name is Chase, and I know you guys know who I'm talking about. They watch this little kid do shit all day, and that's all they care about is Chase. And look, I wear a size 14 shoe, Robbie. I got to keep it real, man. I just have to. I'm sorry. But I love you.
It's good. It's good.
Yeah. Okay. Bigfoot.
I wear a size 6. Very big heads run in my family. Very small feet. Petite feet. Excellent dancers, though. Excellent.
Hey, man.
Thanks for that.
Like angels.
I can see Briar just spinning around right now. Fuck.
All right. I think that's going to wrap it up.
We can talk about the Super Bowl for a bit.
Great dancers.
What are we going to talk about? We're going to go downstairs. I'm going to turn on the TV, watch the Patriots win, go to bed happy. There's
for the Super Bowl, though. That's big.
Is it?
What? Yeah, I'm trying to see how.
Yes.
Okay.
I mean, I think it is. It's the Switch being advertised to 100 plus million people. People that have probably never heard of it. This is big for them.
Let's switch over to this person.
And then, hey, did you guys hear about the rumors? There might be a new Red Dead Redemption 2 trailer.
To the lingerie bowl.
As well.
Yes.
That's big. You guys didn't hear about
switch
that?
Switch the channel. I'm sorry. I was making Switch jokes.
I know.
I like the haircut, Robbie. It looks great.
Same yeah, you look right. Good. Looking good.
Like the next John Connor from Terminator. I like it.
All right, guys. We're going to wrap it up before I make any more dick jokes. Yeah. Been on a long string of them lately. Thank you guys very much for hanging out. I had fun in the chat tonight, too. You guys were hilarious.
It was great. Yeah.
Thanks, everybody, for hanging out. Gary, thank you for the phone call yesterday. I really appreciate that. Gary spent an hour of his day just talking to me about VR, which I really appreciated.
Thanks a lot, Gary.
Yeah, thank you, Gary. Really. So that's going to do it for this episode. We'll see you next week.
See you guys later.
Bye.
Now's that time where we have that long, awkward pause.
Lol.